Amen. Glad you're here today. Really glad you're here today. We're in Luke chapter 6. Can I get an amen? Amen. Because we've been in Luke chapter 5 for a long time. But we have moved on to Luke chapter 6. Praise be to God. So why we go through the books of the Bible like this is because the Scripture teaches us, and I firmly believe, that every word in God's Word is useful. Scripture tells us that it's useful for instruction, for teaching, for equipping the saints, for the ministry, right? So it's everything in here has a purpose, and so we don't want to leave anything out. So we start at the beginning of a book, and we work our way all the way through it. And whatever is in there, we deal with it as it comes. If you left it to me, there would be about 5 topics that you would hear from me every fifth week you would hear it. The same thing again and again and again, because I have a soapbox just like you have a soapbox. And so that's what you would hear. So this way, this prevents me from doing that. This forces me to deal with whatever the text is dealing with. And it helps us, because we don't want to just know God's Word. Like that's not the point. We don't want to just know it. We want it to shape our life. I want to be shaped by the Word of God. I want to have His Word in me so much that it just comes out of me, the way I live, the way I think, the way I talk, all of that. That's the whole point of it. If Scripture is not shaping the way you live, then we're doing something wrong, right? We're doing something wrong. That's my point. So we approach it one verse, one paragraph, one word at a time, and working our way through it. Luke chapter 6 is where we are today. Maybe you remember back when you were a kid. Ed, you remember can you remember that far back? Ed, not sure Ed can, but most of us can, right? Most of us can remember back when we were kids, back in the day. And you remember, Mr. Dickey, I know. So you remember back in the day when you and a friend, right? Your best friend.
I remember.
You'd be best friends and you'd be hanging out. You'd be doing everything together. And then sooner or later, it just kind of fell apart. You were fighting. And you're not even sure why you were fighting. But it was a knockdown, drag out. And you couldn't stand each other for probably 24 hours or so, right? And then you kind of like, oh, I don't have anything to do, so I better go hang out with them, right? Did that happen to you all as well as it did to me? It happened all the time. Like, my friends were my relatives. My friends were my relatives. So my cousin actually was probably my best friend growing up when I was a kid. And we did we lived in a town much smaller than Rock Hall. It was smaller than Skinner's Neck. I mean, it was smaller than, it was small. I mean, I'm saying it was small town. So we lived like 2 doors down from each other, right? So we were neighbors. We went to school together. We went to church together, like 5 days a week, it seemed like. our dads worked together, so we ate dinner together pretty much several nights a week. We would eat dinner together. So we were together all the time. So I'm sure you can expect that every now and then we had these kind of falling outs, right? Just like you have now with your wife or your family members. Like sometimes, so I can only take so much of your goodness. Like, sometimes we got to get some space, right? It just happens. It just happens. I remember one time that everything was great. And then I got comfortable and I started, where it always happens is that we start taking advantage of the relationship, right? And I did that and I said some things and did some things and broke some things and we probably got in a fight. And I remember leaving to walk home. And I felt terrible. I mean, I felt awful for the things I'd said and done. Of course, fortunately, 2 days later, we were back to spending time together because there wasn't anybody else around, right? So it was short-lived, but there for a little while, I felt awful. I mean, I felt bad. I had become his frenemy. You know what a frenemy is? Maybe you don't. So a frenemy is really is a person who seems to be a friend, but in reality, they're not. They're working against you. Like they maybe they're spreading rumors about you, or they're gossiping about you, or they're you step out and expect them to have your back, and you turn around, and there's nobody there, right? Actually, they're standing in front of you with the knife, right? They're like, or they already have it in your back, right? That is that frenemy is that person that should be a friend, should be somebody I count on, but yet I come to find out that they're actually the ones who are trying to undermine me. You know what I'm talking about? You experience those people? You've probably been that person every now and then, once or twice at least in your life. It just kind of happens that maybe you didn't intend it, but that's just kind of the way it worked out because we're not malicious people, but things happen, right? Relationships come and relationships go, especially friendships, unless you're really committed to them, like in marriage kind of thing. But yeah, so those kind of friendships happen, and that frenemy is reality and when we deal with people. Jesus today in Luke chapter 6, we see his frenemies come out of the woodwork. He's starting to deal with his frenemies. So if you're there in Luke chapter 6, it doesn't take a whole lot of setup to find out where we are. I would remind you, though, that Jesus' ministry is growing like gangbusters, right? I mean, he's drawing crowds, and they don't fit in the synagogue anymore. They've got to preach out in the fields or down by the lakeshore, place, things like that, because there's too many people, right? There's a line of people there to be healed, and everything else is going on. And yet, Jesus is now coming out. He's telling people, like, I'm here to bring about the kingdom of God. I'm showing you the kingdom of God as I heal, as I teach. I'm showing you the kingdom of God is coming in. Watch, pay attention, right? He says, I'm the Son of Man. He says, I forgive sin, right? He's been saying these things, and he's becoming more and more outspoken about who he really is. There for a while, he told people, don't tell anybody. Don't tell anybody. Here lately, he's been kind of saying it himself in chapter 5. And then today we find him, he just comes right out and says it. So if you have a Bible, I hope you do, the verses are here on the screen, but I always ask us to use our own Bible because you can underline and highlight stuff and fold a page over so you come back to it and all that sort of thing. So Luke chapter 6, verses 1 through 5, it starts off in verse 1. One Sabbath, we don't know which one, we don't know if it was a week after the where we were before, we don't know. But anyway, one Sabbath, Jesus is going through the grain fields with his disciples, and they begin to pick some heads of grain, rub them in their hands, and eat the kernels. Some of the Pharisees ask, why are you doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath? Jesus answers, have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry? He entered the house of God, and he ate the bread, the consecrated bread. He ate what was lawful for only priests to eat. And he also gave some to his companions. Then Jesus said to them, the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. So it's kind of like, okay, there seems to be some details there that we missed. And I've got that whole scripture passage in there, but I'm going to fast through it here. We'll come back to it later on. There's a lot in that story there that Jesus, he's picking grain, and all of a sudden I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. Like, something happened there that we're not sure. So let's answer. So these three questions that popped out to me when I read through it is what does David have to do with this, right? What's the deal with the Sabbath and eating grain? And then finally, who are these Pharisees who feel like they're the ones that get to enforce the laws? Who are they? So let's look at that. What's the story of David? What does he have to do with picking grain, right? Jesus is picking grain, husking it by hand. Have you ever done that before? You know, y'all are country enough that maybe y'all husk some rub the wheat in your hand and got the chaff, blew it out, and then ate it. I used to do that all the time when I was a kid, whether it was soybeans or corn or wheat or whatever. It doesn't taste good at all. But if you're hungry, I guess it would work, right? But it doesn't taste. My dad loved to eat raw field corn. I mean, he'd just stop on the side of the road and go pull a couple of ears while he was driving down the road. And I was just like, ugh, that stuff tastes awful. But that's what he did. That's a tangent. It's free. You can take that. If you're hungry, it may work, right? But you wouldn't do it for fun. But they said, so it wasn't that, you know, what Jesus is doing with his men, you know, it's not against the law. It's not against the law what they were doing. It's when they were doing it. They were doing it on the Sabbath. That's what they had a problem with. They had a problem with Jesus doing it on the Sabbath. And Jesus just kind of calls them out. He says, I mean, these are the teachers of the law. These are the teachers. These are the most learned people in Israel. And Jesus says, haven't you heard about David? Like, of course they read about David. They had memorized all the stories of David. I mean, this was like an insult. Yes, we know about David. Well, apparently you don't. You know, it's kind of their response that yes, we know. Jesus says, well, if you don't know the story of David, David was the king, right? King David. He's also the guy who killed Goliath. You remember that story, maybe, right? Well, in between those two, in between him killing Goliath and becoming king, he was running for his life. A lot of that. He was, the King Saul wanted to kill him. And so in running for his life in 1 Samuel chapter 21, it tells the story of when he leaves and gets on the run, and he's hungry on the run. And he goes to a priest and Nod, and he tells him, he says, I think his name was Abimelech or something like that. I don't even pronounce it. Anyway, he goes to him and he says, the king sent me here to get bread for the men, which was a lie, right? But he didn't. He went there to get bread. He went there to get something to eat. But we overlooked that about David, right? Because he was the king of Israel, right? He was the one that was anointed to be king. So we can overlook the things that David did, right? Because the priest gave it to him. He didn't like go in and take it. The priest gave him the bread. Gave him the bread. Why did the priest give him the bread? Because the priest understood that somebody in need is more important than, I mean, we're going to throw it out anyway. I mean, they got rid of it every day. It was just, you know, this day's allotment of bread, we're not going to eat it, so you might as well eat it. And he said, are your men pure? Right before I just give it to you, I don't want, like, impure people can't be eating this stuff, but we know who David is, and if your men are pure, then okay. And Jesus says, yeah. I mean, David says, yeah, they're undefiled. He says, okay, take the bread. That's who Jesus is. He says, y'all are being very convenient about when you apply the rules, right? He said, nobody fusses about David eating the bread that he wasn't supposed to eat, but here you are coming to us and picking on us or calling us out for picking grain and eating it when I am the Son of Man. He says, I am the Son of Man. I'm Lord over the Sabbath. He said, Son of Man, meaning that I'm the Son of God, right? That I'm in the flesh here. I've been healing people. You've seen me be Lord over creation. I've healed. I've done miracles. You can't deny that. I'm Lord over creation. And if the Sabbath is a gift to creation, then I'm Lord over that too. Well, understandably, they don't like that. Right? Understandably, they don't like that. They say, well, it's not that you were just picking grain. It's that when you're doing it, the Sabbath is a big deal, right? Sabbath is still a big deal for the Jewish people, especially if you're an Orthodox Jew. It's the thing that identified them. It's the thing that made them unique. Everybody had gods they worshipped, but not many people were as devout about their holy day as the Jews were. No one was. They still aren't. They were commanded by God to observe the Sabbath every seventh day, to work six and rest. To work six and rest. It was part of God's pattern in creation, right? Remember, you know that from Genesis. It was God's, the way he created. It was a gift for his people to be restored, to be renewed, to recover, right? A day to worship their God. The one who provided everything for them. It was a gift to them. And yet, the Pharisees were making it an obligation. Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 through 11 tells us where it came from. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day, there it is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither your son, your daughter, your male or female servant, your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and earth and the sea and all that's in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. This is a big deal. God set aside the seventh day as a witness that creation, as and that's part of it, need this pattern of rest from our work. See, we don't rest for our work. We rest from it. We rest from it. Now, it's such an important day that eventually it's going to come up that, yeah, but can I cut my grass? And the question is, I'm an accountant. I don't cut grass for a living. It's not work to me to cut grass. It's actually refreshing to cut grass. I get out there and I just can I cut my grass? But Steve, he actually cuts grass for a living. And so it's a job for him, but it's not a job for me. So can I cut my grass? He can't cut grass, but can I? Because it's not work. What about if somebody falls and breaks their leg? Can we help them? Is that work? I don't drive an ambulance, but can I drive them to the hospital? Where do we draw the line on what's work and what's not? So they have to decide. And so the people who are the Jewish authorities, right, the rabbinic law, the people who were the attorneys in the day, right, they sorted it out, and we all agreed on. They came up with 39 categories for work. 39 categories for work that you couldn't do on the Sabbath. I don't know if you can see them all, but there they are. And those still exist today. And each one of them, not only was it 39 categories, but each one of them had a series of things underneath it that you couldn't do, like how it applied, like how you understood what it meant to carry. Like carrying, what does carrying mean? Can I wear something? Yes, you can wear it. Can I wear jewelry? Yes, you can wear anything that weighs less than a dried prune. Right? So they had to figure that out. So what does it mean? So how does this apply? Like if I were to come over to your, or you were to come over to my house this afternoon, you would find me watching the race, and I'm going to be eating some peanuts. And you'd say, oh, you can't do that. And I'd say, what are you talking about? He said, well, you're shelling your peanuts. That's harvesting. That's, where does it fit in there? That's one of them. I had the word, and it just left me. But you can't do that. You can't separate the grain. You can't even select the grain. Like, you can't even, like, you can't do any of that stuff. So eating peanuts, you got to take care of that on Friday, and then on Saturday, you can just eat them out of the bowl. That's how technical it got. Another one, that don't come over if you're going to sneeze. Yeah, I mean, you think about how difficult this gets, because you can't tear. Tearing is one of the deconstruct, demolishing in there. You can't tear things. And so if you're going to sneeze, you better have tissues, because you can't tear off the toilet paper. So if you have a tissue, then you got another problem if you got a tissue, because you can't throw it away. You can't take it and put it in the trash. You have to, like, fold it up and stack them up. I don't even know if you can fold them. I don't know if it's allowed to fold, because that'd be part of washing clothes and whatnot. So you might have to just blow your nose and stack them, and then tomorrow you can come over and you can throw them away, because I'm not picking up your dirty tissue. Like, right? Or I guess you could just go outside. But if you do go outside, you got to be really careful that if you're going to sneeze outside, you got to make sure you do it in the grass. Because if it falls into the mud, it's going to make mortar, and that would be working. You see how kind of crazy it gets? Like how difficult it would be to live that way? And yet these Pharisees, this is how they live their lives, to honor God. You understand how hard that would be to live like that? And they chose to do it to honor God. You know, we give Pharisees a bad rap. But in reality, these folks were devout followers of God. I mean, it was no joke to them. They were serious about their faith. Today, thanks to the internet, we look for ways how to get around it, obviously. If you were a Jew who was worried about following the law, right, you would Google online, how can I get around the Sabbath, the rabbinical laws for Sabbath? And you would find websites that would teach you how to do this, for instance. Since you can't, the Sabbath law was you couldn't travel more than 2,000 cubits from your home, which is about 3/4 of a mile. You can't go more than 3/4 of a mile from your home. You can't drive, so you can't, you know, you're not going to walk much further than that anyway, right? So in order to get by, because sometimes I'm going to need to go a little further than 3/4 of a mile, so what you do is you go in your front yard and you dig up some dirt and you put it in your pocket and you take that with you. And that way, you've always got home right there, right in your pocket. Right in your pocket. And another way they do it is that, you know, since they only measure distance on land, they don't really do it on the water, because it's hard to measure 2,000 cubits on the water. So they wouldn't do it. It's not as strict on the water. So what you could do is, if you were, you know, since you can't drive, you'd have to, you know, get in your wagon or whatever, you could actually put some water bottles under your seat. And that way you would actually be traveling on the water. And you could go further. See what I'm saying? So there are ways to get around it. And that's how we become, is that we want to get around something. When something that was given as a gift to God's people became an obstacle that had to be gotten around. It had to be manipulated. And all those attempts to manipulate are defeating the whole purpose. Because the whole point of it is, it's your heart in it, right? It's the desire to serve and honor God. And if you're just trying to get around, get away with something, then what's really the point? But these 39 that were put in place by the Talmud, they're real. And people really live by them. Over 2,700 pages, right, of the Talmud that explain these laws. 2,700 pages of law of how to live your life as an Orthodox Jew. That they judge. That religious leaders judge. Back in Jesus' day, those judges were the ones that were called the Pharisees. That's who they were. They were the ones who sorted it out. They knew all the scripture. They knew the law. They knew how to apply it. They knew all these rabbinic laws, right? They knew how to figure out the, well, what if, and what about this one, and all that. They'd been through it all. And so those were the folks that the Pharisees were. That's who the Pharisees were in Jesus' day. They were the ones who had influence. I mean, that you wanted your sons to grow up and be one of them because they had influence. They were well respected in the community. Jesus tells them, I'm the Son of Man. I'm the Son of Man. I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. He says, look, I've shown my power over creation as I've healed, and now you bring me these restrictions of the Sabbath law, and I'm telling you that actually I am Lord over it. Creation was a gift, and I'm in charge of that gift. Man, this was too much for them. They immediately set out to, okay, we got to do something about this Jesus. So people got to hear about this guy being the fraud that he really is, that he is, he's teaching things contrary to the law, and people have got to be aware. So, on the next Sabbath, or a Sabbath, verse 6, he went into the synagogue. He is Jesus. Went into the synagogue, was teaching. And a man was there whose right hand was shriveled. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus. So they watched him closely to see if he would heal on the Sabbath. Because they knew he would. They've heard the stories of Jesus healing people every day. It doesn't matter. They know he's going to heal. If he sees somebody who needs it, he's going to act. And so they stacked the deck. But Jesus knew what they were thinking and said to the man with the shriveled hand, get up, stand in front of everyone. So he got up, stood there. Then Jesus said to him, to them, to the Pharisees, I ask you, which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil, to save life or to destroy it? He looked around at all of them, and then he said to the man, stretch out your hand. He did so, and his hand was completely restored. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law were furious and began to discuss with one another what they might do to Jesus. A good deed, poorly received, right? He did a good thing. You ever done that? You ever said something to somebody that you meant as a positive, and they took it completely the wrong way? Like, that's kind of what Jesus, except Jesus this time, he knew what they were doing, and he walked right into it anyway. He gave it to them anyway. He knew what they were going to do. Jesus knew they were trying to trap him. So he asked them a question. Which is right to do, good or evil on the Sabbath? Which is right to do, to save or destroy life? Now, obviously those have the right answer, right? It's to save. It's life, to give life on the Sabbath. That's the right answer. And yet, crickets. The other scriptures tell us that Jesus was angry at the Pharisees because of their hard-heartedness. Just they couldn't bring themselves to say, yeah, you got us. It's to give life on the Sabbath. That's what we're supposed to do. But they couldn't say it. You ever been there where you knew you were, somebody got you, right? And you were like, oh, man, leave it. That's what they were like. They were like, oh, he got us. He saw right through our little trick. Jesus asked the man to stand up and stretch out his hand. Some of you need to hear this part. Some of you need to read that verse again. But he asked the man to stand up and stretch out his hand. The Lord may be asking you to do something that you can't do. This man couldn't. He had a bad hand. He's like, Jesus says, put your hand out there. He said, well, Jesus, I can't. He could have said that. Jesus, I can't. You know my hands doesn't work. Jesus said, stretch your hand out. It took an act of faith before he could do it, right? He couldn't do it. He couldn't do it on his own. It might be something that God's asking you to do that you can't do, that you need him for. It's an act of faith. It's an act of faith to actually believe that God is going to lead me to it. God is going to help me do this. Like, I don't know how. God is going to meet you in that. That may be the message from the Lord that he's asking you that. He might ask you today or tomorrow. Trust him if he asks. Jesus heals the hand and it's completely restored. Now, just to be clear, it wasn't wrong to heal somebody. It was just wrong to heal somebody who wasn't critically injured on the Sabbath. Like, if he was dying, yes, they could help the man, but he wasn't dying. His hand had been that way for a long time. He was just, you know, Jesus could have said, come back on Sunday. I can help you tomorrow. But no, Jesus said, no, as a man in need, I'm going to meet his need today, right? It was important to Jesus. Why withhold good from somebody in need? So right there on the Sabbath, Jesus heals the man. And at that moment, the Pharisees turn from friends of God into frenemies. Frenemies of God. Just that quick. They couldn't see it. They couldn't see that their standard of the law was actually getting in the way of what God, the Son of God, was doing. They couldn't see it. How did they get there? Three quick little things that I think we are prone to struggle with ourselves. First one is their traditions that were given to them to share became means to holiness. And Moses gave them the traditions of their faith, right? To observe all of these practices, the fast, the Lent, the whatever we do, right? They're given to us as a tradition for us to remember. Same with Moses. He gave the traditions of the Jewish faith, right? The festivals, the practices were all to point them to God. That was the reason. But since this is what we do, the things that we do but to remember eventually become mean a way to become holy. If I do them, then I'm a holy person. If I observe the Sabbath, then I must be okay with God. Right? If I go to church every week, then I must be okay with God. If I pray all the time, or I pray three times a day, then I must be okay with God. Instead of seeing them as a tradition, a way to connect, it becomes a means to holiness. See, we come to church because we know we're loved, not to get loved. Paul wrote in Colossians chapter 2, since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you still belong to the world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These rules, which have to do with things that are all destined to perish with use, are based on merely human commands and teachings. Such regulations have the appearance of wisdom with self-imposed worship, their false humility, and their harsh treatment. The restrictions, they seem like they're good because, man, they're hard. But in reality, they're frauds. They don't make you holy. They're ways of the world. They're ways of man. They seem like a means to holiness, but they're not. But we take these means of holiness, right? And since they become so important, this thing is so important when we build rules around what you can do and what you can't do, how you have to do it. Like, we have rules for it because if it's important, you need rules. And if you're going to have rules, you got to enforce them. Can I get an amen from the parents in the room, right? If you got rules, you got to enforce them. Amen. Except the one whose faith is weak, Paul wrote, without quarreling over disputable matters. One person's faith allows them to eat anything, but another whose faith is weak eats only vegetables. The one who eats everything must not treat with contempt the one who does not. The one who does not eat everything must not judge the one who does, for God has accepted them. This is key. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? To their own master, servants stand or fall, and they will stand, for the Lord is able to make them stand. So what he's saying here is that, you know, You have a view of Scripture that tells you that you have to do this, this, and this. You have a view of Scripture that says, I don't have to do any of that. What I have to do is the basics. You want to add all these other things on top of it. They say, no, we don't. You say, they're wrong. You say, no, they're wrong. What Paul is saying here is that stop it. Just stop it. You're going to be responsible for what you do, and you're going to be responsible for what you do, right? And Christ works in all of it. Christ works in all of it. So stop blaming, stop pointing out how they're not holy enough and they're too holy, right? I mean, it doesn't mean you get to do any old thing you want, right? Don't pick up what I'm not putting down. Like, it doesn't mean that. But what it does mean is that if you want to add things to Scripture, like, you're going to be responsible for that. Like, if you want to be more restrictive, be more devout, then great. But don't put that on someone else. If you want to fast, fast. If you want to pray 7 times a day, then pray. But don't make that a requirement for someone else. And the final step is they make human rules more important than God's intention. We make those rules that we develop to safeguard our traditions more important than what God intended from the very beginning. We saw that in the Pharisees, right? That they made these rules to protect the Sabbath day, what work looked like, right? They made all these rules, and those were the ones that became the things they safeguarded. The things they were safeguarding from the commandment to not work on the Sabbath. And so they wound up even plotting to kill Jesus on the Sabbath, which is amazing to me. Here they are plotting to kill the Son of God on the Sabbath and accusing him of breaking the Sabbath. Amazing. Mark 7, 1 through 9 says, the Pharisees and some of the teachers of the law who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus one time. This is a different account. And some of his disciples eating food with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. Pharisees, though, they do not eat until they have poured water over their cupped hands as required by their ancient traditions, the tradition of the elders. When they come to the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash, and they observe many other traditions, such as washing of cups, pitchers, and kettles, all the law. So the Pharisees and teachers of the law asked Jesus, why don't your disciples live according to the tradition of the elders instead of eating their food with defiled hands? Because everybody knows you're not supposed to do that. Jesus responded, you hypocrites. Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. As it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They say the right things, but they're not living it. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules. They've let go of the commands of God and are holding on to human traditions. And he continued, you have a fine way of setting aside the commands of God in order to observe your own traditions. Church, don't let us do that. Don't let us accept the standards of man instead of the standards of God. Don't let us ever do that. Either way, the way of man in the world or the way of man in leading the church, be one that takes us away from the way of God. You see, whether it was David getting bread for his men or Jesus giving grain to his disciples or healing a man on the Sabbath, God's will is for people, period. God's will is always for people. And Jesus is here to show us the truth of that. Now, we United Methodists have always been known as a big tent denomination. What I mean by that is that we have people that have varying degrees. We don't have a doctrinal statement that you have to sign in order to be a member of our church. We don't have that. So some denominations do. And that's good and bad and all of the above, right? But what it doesn't do is it allows us to sort ourselves out in a bunch of different ways. One of those ways is I've kind of sorted out is we either have police faith or we have firefighter faith. We have police faith. I'm not pointing to y'all have police faith. But the two ways we see the world through our theological lens, right? How we understand what God requires of us through police faith or firefighter faith. What do I mean by that? My first day on the job as the Queen Anne's County chaplain years ago, first night, I hadn't done anything other than, you know, some procedural stuff. And then they say, well, we'll call you when we need you. Feel free to come drop by anytime you want, blah, 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 you know, all that kind of thing. Well, that night, about 2 o'clock in the morning, I get a phone call. Like, phone goes off, and I'm like, oh, my Lord, what in the world? And it's the sheriff's office. I'm like, oh, my goodness, first night. And there, an officer had been shot. I was like, oh, my good Lord. So I get up and rubbing the stuff out of my eyes, you know, and they said, you want us to come get you or you want to drive? And I said, no, please, let's don't start with that. I'll drive, so I'll just meet you there. And so I met there at the barracks, and I mean, everybody obviously was concerned about their coworker, right? He had just been shot, and he was fighting for his life and all of that. But what amazed me was how focused they were on who was wrong, on making sure they got the legal stuff in order, that they got all the evidence in place, that they got the procedures down. And like, he's in the hospital. Okay, so did they do this? Did they do that? Did they do that? Like, they were just bam, 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 going through all this stuff, right? It was amazing to me how the perspective was only on the procedure, on the law. A year and a half ago, my wife and I had an accident here outside of town, a wreck. And the police didn't show up. But if they would have, I thought about this, if a policeman had shown up, he would have stuck his head in my truck and he'd said, are y'all okay? And we'd have said, yeah. And he would have left. Right? He said, your truck's not on fire, you're good. I'm going to go over here and direct traffic. Right? That's kind of what he would have done. A firefighter comes along, right? And what's he going to do? Well, I'll tell you what they did. They start tearing my truck apart. Like, literally, cutting the roof off and everything else. They're like, we're getting you out of there. They don't worry about directing traffic because they just park their big old trucks right across the road. Ain't nobody coming through. We're just going to block the traffic. Right? They don't care about, did you cross the center line? Were you drinking? They didn't ask none. They didn't care. Are you okay? Are you okay? Are you breathing? Like, anything broken? Like, all they cared about was us. Getting us somewhere where we can be taken care of. Right? That was it. Policeman, he wouldn't have been cared about that. He'd been trying to figure out who did it, whose fault it was. I think we each fall on one side or the other. We're more worried about with who did what, was it right? Or we're worried about, oh man, but they're just broken. We need to help them. We tend to fall in one side or the other. And I just want to tell you that the truth is somewhere between them. That yes, we love people, and yes, we are for the law. Yes, we're for truth, which includes love and includes right and wrong. There's no one or the other. It's both. Our love is seen not in how well we follow the law, not in how well we help people. Our love for God is revealed in how we love others, and that love includes truth. Includes it. We can't just tell people what we think. It's got to be love. It's got to be love. And who defines love? I don't. God does. God does. I think of today being Sunday, our Sabbath, as Protestant Christians. And the purpose of the Sabbath was to restore life, to bless. And I think of how this day might be the best day to show that love to somebody else. Like, of all the days of the week, this might be the one that would be the most accurate day of the week to actually show God's love to somebody. That's what this day is all about. I encourage you, as we're going to receive grace and the elements of Holy Communion, I invite you to accept it as an equipping of God to go out and love your neighbor, to see somebody in need. And don't just pass by the other side like the Samaritans, right? Like the Jews did in the parable of the Good Samaritan. But no, seeing someone in need and not meeting the need is, this is a strong word, seeing someone in need and not answering the need is evil. It's evil. It's opposed to God's will for his love for people. You can't just walk by it. You have to get involved. He requires us to.
His love does. Today we'll be equipped to step in. Let's pray. God, we thank you. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for this meal, this moment to share with you. God, use it to equip us for mighty works.